Good morning. How are you, Sam?
Good. Yeah. How are you?
Yeah.
Been busy?
I have, yeah. No. Well, welcome to the hangar.
Thank you. Bit of a random question.
Yeah.
Do you think that the aviation industry is broken?
Ooh, that's a good one. I think as an industry, it is sluggish. Progress is incremental, and the bureaucracy of the aviation authorities, who with the best will in the world are trying to maintain standards of safety, have just created an industry response that is fat and in some cases happy. Not all the aviation industry is like that. And it stifles innovation. There is too much paperwork. You cannot inspect quality into something. You have to design it in. You know, is it broken?
Yeah.
Well, it's not fixed. It's not fixed.
Well, hopefully HX50 will do that.
Well, I think so, yeah. You know, and a lot of people say, you might even have heard it said too, this is too good to be true. You know, what HX50 is and what Hill helicopters are doing is too good to be true. Well, it's not when you look at what the way it's being done and what I would call the concurrent engineering. I mean, the HX50 is the obvious exceptional outcome of Hill Helicopters' new way of doing new product development. It's their process, working in integrated teams, using the best of technology that is available, and at the center of it, before he did anything, was ask what the customer wanted and deliver it.
Part of the 100 Club?
Yep, the Hill 100 Club, first 100 to buy, taking risk.
Yeah, so that's like the first 100 serial numbers.
Correct, right? Yeah, it's okay. The first 100 serial numbers. Yeah.
I'm not a part of it, so what's it like?
Well, it's the beginning of the Hill ownership community,
right.
The first 100, and at the moment it's absolutely good fun to be part of really an excited group of people who are influencing the development of the aircraft. I was fully intending to do the two more long-range journeys, the Greenland and another around the world at higher latitudes through the tundra. And then we're going to rebuild that R66. That would have been taken to its point where it would be rebuilt, and I would have had the experience of living through its whole life.
Yeah.
And then getting to the point where I understand, working with the team who had maintained her, we rebuild her, which is a sort of standard process, and putting right and changing out the essential parts that need changed out with the kit you get from Robinson. So it would have been essentially a brand new helicopter again. And I like the R66 as a machine. I mean, we chose it. It was the machine to choose in 2015. It may not be, I mean, not everyone flies around the world, clearly, but what I wanted was something that could carry everything I needed, which is what we used it for. After training as a mechanical engineer, was running companies that helped improve the performance of product development processes.
Yeah.
And I started out working for engineering companies and then with transferable skills, feeling much more comfortable about working for a variety of industries. For what we're talking about, working for Airbus and Rolls-Royce on their new product development programs and helping their product development teams was where my management consulting career went in the early days of me running my businesses. I think it was 1988, roughly. I didn't really have the time resources to do it, but at the weekends, instead of playing golf, and I don't play golf, I had some time to do some flying. So a little Robinson 22, which I know you've had a look at, and they're quite tiny.
Compared to maybe something like the R60, is there any difference in that?
Well, absolutely. I mean, for me, the whole project is exciting. I mean, the HX50 doesn't exist as you can sit in it and fly it yet. On another level, it exists as an engineer. To me, it exists inside the simulated models, the design intent, the way Jason has used what I, for my engineering consulting career, was explaining companies could be doing. They could be listening to the customer and really understanding what they want. So in that sense, it's a journey for an engineer who also likes helicopters. Yeah. But as a product, it's outstanding. What is the HX50? I mean, it's faster, it's more powerful, it's beautiful to look at. It does ergonomically everything that I could imagine I wanted and couldn't get in the R66, but worked towards when I was flying, making things ergonomic for myself when I was doing my missions. It's cheaper than the R66. It's less costly to maintain than the R66. I mean, as a proposition for a private pilot, it answers a lot of the questions about, can I afford, you know, would I do this? Yeah, I think what I and Jason found useful was, we're both engineers, he's probably a better one than I am, we both fly the R66, and the experiences I'd had, which I had taken in thinking by talking to people to prepare for the Africa trip, but then when I'd flown Africa, I thought, you know what, I need cables here, and I need this there on the helicopter, and I wish that could be different. I'd recorded all these sort of ergonomic and practical things, and without modifying the helicopter, because you may not do that, I'd got a bracket here for this and so on. And I, after the round the world trip, had even more ideas. How do I stay cool? And then when I went around Latin America, which is windy, there were other issues and so on. So I was able to explain to him what I would want sitting in a helicopter for a long time, a comfortable helicopter. There's lots of things that are in the design specification, which he's already imagined would work. But it's more than that. The ergonomics are just out of this world. To look at the instrument panel, which you've seen, and they're all there. You can fly these things. You look at his instrument panel, it's got three main instruments. All the information's there. It's an advance that makes it easier, safer to use, and everything's there.
Could we have a look inside?
Yeah, we could have a look inside. This is basically your flying instruments. There are some engine, typical engine RPMs, and in this case it's a turbine, so it's torque. But a two-axis autopilot, which is what this has got, is what was installed for around the world after my brownout experience.
Where did that happen?
It happened when I was in the south of Algeria, having flown in the desert, thinking this is going well, 12 hours across the Sahara, which I'd never done before, and I was flying from a place called Taman Rasset out of Algeria, which is the port of exit, into Niger, which is the next country down, going to its capital called Agadez,
right.
And at 7,500 feet, it was fine, but it just seemed like this brown haze was coming up and up and up. I just got enveloped by this, and
wow.
I couldn't see anything. I couldn't go down because it got worse, and I couldn't go up. I unwittingly ended up in conditions where you couldn't see. Two, what would you do if you couldn't see? So an autopilot or two pilots that make it safer. The solution. So what we ended up was a sponsored autopilot from the people who provide this system. And two pilots for around the world.
Yeah.
Which was continuous process improvement, in my view. What I did was I wrote this one first, which was the kind of novel. I'd always wanted to write a novel, and it was harder writing this book than it was planning for this mission.
It's
tough to write.
Also, you've got a world record.
Yeah, it was
Yeah, that, it's taken a long time. It's 2017 we did it, the around the world record, and it's the record for the antipode, right. Landing a helicopter first time through antipodes, equatorial antipodes.
What an incredibly insightful day to meet someone that's actually travel around the entire world in a helicopter. I think if that doesn't sound crazy to you, it's crazy to me, like just the thought. Incredible.